DFA Assistant Secretary Paul Raymond Cortez is now with us to provide updates for the case. Good morning, Asa Cortez, and welcome to Head Start.
Good morning and a wonderful day to everyone and to all those who are watching as well.
Our pleasure having you on the program, ASEC. Can you please give us a quick timeline of what happened to our kababayan, please?
All right. On July 13th, early morning, a body was found along the Tsingyi Pier Station. Quickly, the passersby or those who were early morning joggers that alerted the police. This was at about 6:30 in the morning, and by 7 a.m., the police had declared that the body that they had found was officially dead. And quickly, I brought the body to the morgue where they identified the body together with the personal effects that were on the Filipino. And thereafter was informed the family, the next of kin back here in the Philippines, and the employer as well. Where the overseas Filipino had been working for. And since then, the Philippine Consulate General in Hong Kong had been closely coordinating with the Tsingyi Police Station regarding the investigation on why, what the cause of death was. And also together with the Migrant Workers Office in Hong Kong had coordinated with the employer to find out exactly what plans are related to the repatriation of the remains of the deceased and the personal belongings of the deceased, including what is due, the last remaining salaries and emoluments due our overseas Filipino.
Mm-hmm. We understand, ASEC, that the family doesn't want to release the name of their kin, of course, but would also want to know, is there any movement when it comes to the autopsy, at least? Do we know the cause of the death of our kababayan OFW?
Well, they're still being monitored together with the Hong Kong authorities. Rest assured that the family will be officially informed as to the cause of death. And everything that is due the overseas Filipino will be sent to them.
Mm-hmm. But the was about the police investigation, I'm sorry about this. Is it already confirmed if the cause of death is an accident or is there foul play involved?
There is still no official cause of death, but foul play is hopefully not in the picture. The police are not looking at any of that sort of incriminating circumstance for the death of our overseas Filipino. But nonetheless, we still await the official results and hope that once these are available, this will be made known to the family for certain closures as far as they are concerned as well.
Mm-hmm. I have read reports, ASEC, that the employer of the Filipina reported that she was missing to the police. Is the employer also being questioned or is he being looked at as a possible suspect on what happened?
As far as we know, ma'am, the employer is not a person of interest in mm-hmm. this case.
Mm-hmm. What about the Hong Kong government? Are they offering assistance to our Filipino OFW?
Well, the Hong Kong government law enforcement authorities are in close touch with the Philippine government representatives mm-hmm. in Hong Kong to make sure that the investigation is a thorough one that will stand the rigors of scientific tests and all that, so that there is no reason to doubt whatever the results of the investigation would come up with.
So far, what has the DFA been doing when it comes to assistance for her family and for the repatriation of the remains as well?
Sure. We've gotten in touch with the family here in the Philippines. We've informed them. They've been informed of the death of their kamag-anak, of their relative. Mm-hmm. They've been informed that there are personal effects that are due to be sent back to them. They're also informed that the employer has made sure that the end of service benefits mm-hmm. and the other salaries and emoluments due the overseas Filipino would be given to them. And of course, the speedy sending of the remains of their relative. Of course, this all depends on the documentation. That's why we have mm-hmm. to wait for or the certificate of the fact of death that will be issued by the Hong Kong government, and thereafter the death certificate, the report of death, and everything else that that is related to the repatriation of the remains.
Mm-hmm. It's good to know that the DFA is here assisting the family of our Filipino OFW. But if you may, Asik, just jump into a different topic now and other matters. What's the latest now on the situation of the Filipinos that are still in Sudan?
There are about 30 left over the weekend, and hopefully we're able to book them in the next couple of days. The difficulty lay in the fact that there was. There is a Hajj, there's a pilgrimage ongoing in the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia, which is why it was very difficult to get flights from Port Sudan, where they were, onto Saudi Arabia. But we're also looking into the possibility of flying them over to Doha. Now, the issue also is some of them do not have passports with them, because in the midst of all the evacuation, they had to leave behind everything, and all they had were clothes on their backs. And our honorary consulate in Khartoum issued travel documentation for them in Port Sudan, which would allow them to travel back to the Philippines. Of course, there's another issue of the entry visas into Saudi Arabia or Doha, if that's where they will be flying on from, going back to Manila. At the same time, there are about 120-ish Filipinos who have opted to stay in Sudan for various reasons, their jobs, they think it's still safe. But we, the embassy in Cairo, the honorary consulate, stand by to assist them if and when they decide to finally leave Sudan for the Philippines.
Mm-hmm. Are we still looking at multiple points of where we're going to be picking up our OFWs?
Well, the easiest point of evacuation would be from the Egyptian-Sudanese border, where majority of our over 750 who are now here had gone through. But the other option would be through Port Sudan, where 30 of our kababayans are now waiting for their flights back here in the Philippines. And we're looking at the two options, but the easier route now would be through Port Sudan, because you do not have to go through the land travel across Egypt the way our majority of our 750 had gone through in the first few weeks following the eruption of the war in Sudan.
So lastly, as of before I let you go, we are still at alert level 4 for the moment.
Yes, we do hope that our kababayans think again about looking for employment in places like Sudan. There are countries that are under alert level 4, which means mandatory evacuation, and yet some of our kababayans still find their ways to being recruited and finally even seeking residence in places like those. And we do hope that they heed the advice of the government, if it's alert level 4 or alert level 3, or if there is a deployment ban, please go through the proper government channels to make sure that we know where you are, and we are more monitoring if and when you need assistance.
Mm-hmm. For the families of those still stuck in Sudan, is there any means for them to be able to, even if not contact their family members, at least know the status of what they're in now?
Luckily, there are still WhatsApp services between Sudan and the rest of the world, which is why not only are we able to get in touch with them, but also their families. The difficult part at this moment is the banking system, and there is actually no way to send money to Sudan or even send money from Sudan. Yeah. And that's the hard part. But we do have our honorary consul, Tariq Nefraidi, who is on top of the situation, and he has been helping out with advancing the expenses of our Filipinos who wish to evacuate the country.
All right, and with that, I'll let you go. Asik, thank you for your time and for updating us with what's happening around the world. You have a good morning ahead of you.
Have a great morning as well. Thank you.
Thank you. That was DFA Asik Paul Cortez joining us on the program.